Thank you. Chilly day in Utah.
Yes, it is.
The snow in the mountains and nobody can escape. I like that rose.
Yeah, you know, it was still pretty when the rest of them faded, so I thought, well, I'm going to just put it in a little vase and keep it till it goes bad.
Bad.
There's several of them on the bush now. They look really pretty. Okay. Well, gang, we're not reading the Enuma Elish. I could not find anything that was, I mean, but the interest, well, let's ring the bell. So we're going to be reading the Quran. Okay. But it's interesting because the Enuma Elish talks about all the god, all these different gods, not one god, but many gods, and how this person had this and the fight, I mean, the wars between the gods. It's interesting. But it'll go on and then it'll say something, 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 and then I should bring it and read, show you. And then it's blank. And then it'll say something blank. And then another, maybe another word after that. And you can't, it's not really readable in a class like this. It's just kind of, and so many footnotes. And they're all, it doesn't make sense to read it. It's about creation and how, you know, the waters and blah, 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 all the different things were made, just kind of similar to Genesis. And it does, you know, reference Genesis in some of the footnotes and some of the preface and all that sort of thing. And but it is interesting that it's just like all the other creation stories, which start where you know it's not really the beginning. Because somebody made, you know, a god made the earth. Now, what came before that? You know, it's like it's a never-ending story, you know. And it's like, okay, but you're not explaining how the gods came about. Not really. You know, it just starts with, you know, these people or these gods were in existence somehow magically.
Or from outer space. And I think that's, there's so much in there. You're going along, there's so much blanks. I mean, it's, the rest is just conjecture. You know what I'm saying? Somebody just kind of filled in the blanks, and from whatever perspective you're coming from,
it could be different.
Yeah, you can insert it. And it makes sense. So.
Oh, wow.
And about man, you know, the creation of man, they talk about a certain God created man from his blood and bone. You know, which is similar to the Genesis story. And most, so, I mean, the real book that I'd really like to get my hands on is Eden, but I can't get it because it's not, they don't even know if they'll ever have it again. You know, I mean, it's, yeah. Anyway, so, because it's out, nobody has it. You know, I guess there's one place that if a used copy comes in, they can let you know. Eden. Yeah. It's more about women and how women played a role, I think, wasn't it more? This one is just a little bit out there. It's not out there. It's just very difficult to read it. And making,
so much missing information.
Yeah, it's just the tablets were, you know, there's like 7 tablets, I believe, and only 100-some-odd words in each tablet. But there's so much that's been lost because they were clay tablets. So, you know, so that is that. So sorry to disappoint. If you want to look at the book, you can look at the book. I'll let you, you know, look at it. Whatever, I'll have it here at some of them. I'll just bring it over and have it in the thing. But it's just like, even in the introduction, the guy doesn't talk much about all of that. So, so the Quran is the earliest and by far the finest work of classical Arabic prose. For Muslims, it is the infallible word of God, a transcript of a tablet preserved in heaven, revealed to the Prophet Muhammad by the angel Gabriel. That's interesting. Same one that's on the temple, right?
What?
Gabriel?
Yeah.
Isn't that the one that... No, that's Moroni, isn't
Moroni.
It? Moroni, sorry. Except in the opening verses and some few passages in which the prophets or the angel speaks in the first person, the speaker throughout is God. Anyway. I wasn't going to read a whole lot about this, the introduction, unless you want me to go into all of this. Long after Muhammad's call, Arabian paganism was showing signs of decay. What I found interesting, though, was that, you know, the Babylonians and the Sumerians, where the Enuma Elish was supposedly from, had many gods, just like the Egyptians. And then the Hebrews came along and decided it was going to be one God. And they didn't like the fact that they were, you know, worshiping many gods. And which I find interesting. Why? Control?
Yeah, probably that. Maybe it was more modern and
I don't know what
idealism was out of fashion.
I don't know, because what would they be trying to do with that?
Form a new club.
I guess.
And sell it. You know, everybody's involved in this club, and you come up with a new idea,
right,
a new way to sell it. Come on down. We're right, they're wrong. Come on down.
I guess
so. Here's my place.
It's just interesting, you know, that many of the earlier religions talk about many gods, many different gods.
Right.
But they don't explain anything further, or they did, but it was passed down verbally, which is what it says about the Enuma Elish. You know, a lot of these tales were passed down and then later were put down.
Right, but the creation itself, the force, the creative force, the cause of all the gods, which some of them physical society, is just like humankind that simply outstripped us. It also says in Genesis, it talks about in the beginning there was the word. But in Hebrew, before they, you know, retranslated, because the Old Testament is basically the Torah, it's in the beginning there was the word. And so you went from this, you know, in the beginning there was the sound. And so they went from the sound, they translated that into the word. But in Hebrew, it's the sound, right? And sound is just a vibration, has no personality. And so that is what created everything else. So it's, anyway.
Yeah, yeah, no. But still, they don't explain what came prior to that sound.
The no thing.
Because they don't want to talk about that, I guess, because it's too nebulous. It's like, huh? Yeah.
And not that God was created by the force.
Yeah, because we would relate to a God more.
Right.
Well, you put personhood to it. Because if you don't have, if you stick with just the sound or the resonation, that's science. And then you can see that that is changing the sound or the vibration is true in all science, right? And you can't, and the only way to take it away from there and put a personality on it so it can be somebody, can be adopted, right, for whatever cause or religion, you put a personality on it, then you can sell it because now it has humanhood. I don't know if I'm making any sense.
No, absolutely. So, yeah.
Okay, so the first part, the first thing here, it just, the exordium. Well, every single one of these things starts with the same little thing. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the merciful. They always start with that. But I'm not going to say that every single time. I will just go into the paragraph. But this little bit at the beginning, praise be to Allah, Lord of the creation, the compassionate, the merciful, King of the last judgment. You alone we worship, and to you alone we pray for help. Guide us to the straight path, the path of those whom you have favored, not of those who have incurred your wrath, nor of those who have gone astray. When earth is rocked, this is called the earthquake. When earth is rocked in her last convulsion, when earth shakes off her burdens and man asks, what may this mean? On that day, she will proclaim her tidings, for your Lord will have inspired her. On that day, men will come in scattered bands to be shown their labors. Whoever has done an atom's weight of good shall see it. And whoever has done an atom's weight of evil shall see it also. So there again, you know, it's, to me, it's, I don't know if I should say it. It's like a judgment on what is good and what is evil, right?
Self-judgment.
Yeah, could be, yes. most of it is. All of it is, right? Self-judgment. Okay, the cataclysm. When the sky is rent asunder, when the stars are scattered and the oceans roll together, when the graves tumble in ruin, each soul shall know what it has done and what it has failed to do. O man, what evil has enticed you from your gracious Lord, who created and proportioned you and molded your body to his will? Yes, you deny the last judgment. Yet there are guardians watching over you, noble recorders who know of all your actions. The righteous shall surely dwell in bliss, but the wicked shall burn in hell fire upon the judgment day. They shall not escape. Would that you knew the import of that day. Oh, would that you knew the import of that day. It is the day when every soul will stand alone and Allah will reign supreme. Any thoughts on that?
Well, I'm kind of stuck on the initial prayer that goes before each. That brings me back to our conversation about worship. It's just you're asking for something.
Oh.
Please protect us. Please give us this.
The merciful, the compassionate.
Right, exactly. And then in this, like I feel the dogma starts creeping in.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. Unless I'm just not understanding it.
But it's basically almost the same story.
What? The judgment? Yeah. There is a judgment, you know, of your deeds, for sure. Right?
That's inside.
Huh?
But as Quirky explained, it's inside of you.
Yeah.
When you stand and look at your own existence, the things that you've done. Because you'll be conscious at that point, you will see
everything
and where you were astray and how, what you screwed up on and what you need to work on and what your next workout should be.
But who decides that it was a screw up and a whatever?
The person himself is less.
Right. So it's, yeah. So
there's not yet you be judged.
Right. So at that point, is someone conscious enough to see where they, I mean, the only real stray is that you did not become conscious,
right,
and see your real self. To me, that's
right,
really the point.
Right.
It's not all those little things you did wrong or right or whatever. I don't think that's, I don't know. To me, that's not the main thrust. It's, did you find yourself?
Right.
And if you did not, then you have work to do still.
Right, because of
right,
those distractions.
Right. All your
distractions. You need to work on those.
Right. So it is interesting.
So while you're in the meat, physical meat body.
And even when you're over there, you have things to work out, obviously.
Well,
Cork,
sure you do, yeah.
I mean, Cork even said
makes
that.
Sense. Yeah, it makes sense.
Like, as above, so below.
So below, right?
Yeah.
What's a paradox is that finding yourself is finding that you're no one.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
That you're a nobody. But the whole point of that, to me, is that you become one and lose yourself with a greater cause or whatever. And find out that even if you found yourself, you have to lose that and join with a greater what, soul or whatever, in order to move on down the road. You have to do that.
You have to lose it in order to see it.
Right. Anyway, sorry.
Well, it's just like there's mitosis of the soul.
Yeah.
Joining those souls.
Oh, yeah. Exactly. That's the only way you get larger, is by joining. Joining something larger than yourself. But then you become nothing in the process.
Become what? with whatever it is.
Exactly. You lose that
identity. Mm-hmm. Like hydrogen when it becomes helium.
It's no longer hydrogen.
Join together and they become helium, and they're no longer hydrogen. Yet they have both aspects.
Right.
Plus a neutron. They do.
Okay.
Two hydrogen. Two electrons, two protons, and neutrons.
But what's interesting is this reminds me a little of Revelations. The hellfire and all of that stuff. It's again fear and being generated, you know, Next one, the cessation. When the sun ceases to shine, when the stars fall down and the mountains are blown away, when camels big with young and left untended, and the wild beasts are brought together, when the seas are set alight and men's souls are reunited, when the infant girl buried alive is asked for what crime she was, thus slain, when the records of men's deeds are laid open and the heaven is stripped bare, when hell burns fiercely and paradise is brought near, each soul shall know what it has done. I swear by the turning planets and by the stars that rise and set, by the fall of night and the first breath of morning, that this is the word of a gracious and mighty messenger, held in honor by the Lord of the throne, obeyed in heaven, faithful to his trust. No, your compatriot is not mad. He saw him on the clear horizon. He does not grudge the secrets of the unseen, nor is this the utterance of an accursed devil. Whither then are you going? This is an admonition to all men, to those among you that have the will to be upright. Yet you cannot will except by the will of Allah, Lord of the creation. Anyone thought about that one? Okay. Man. Does there not pass over man a space of time when his life is a blank? We have created man from the union of the two sexes so that we may put him to the proof. We have endowed him with sight and hearing, and be he thankful or oblivious to our favors, we have shown him the right path. For the unbelievers, we have prepared fetters and chains and a blazing fire. But the righteous shall drink of a cup tempered at the camphor fountain, a gushing spring at which the servants of Allah will refresh themselves. They who keep their vows and dread the far spread of terrors of judgment day, who for the love of Allah give sustenance to the poor man, the orphan, and the captive, saying, "We feed you for Allah's sake. Only we seek of you neither recompense nor thanks, for we fear from him a day of anguish and of woe. Allah will deliver them from the evil of that day and make their countenances shine with joy. He will reward them for their steadfastness with robes of silk and the delights of paradise. Reclining there upon soft couches, they shall feel neither the scorching heat nor the biting cold. Trees will spread their shade around them, and fruits will hang in clusters over them. They shall be served with silver dishes and beakers as large as goblets, silver goblets which they themselves shall measure, and cups brim full with ginger-flavored water from the fount of Salsabil. They shall be attended by boys graced with eternal youth, who to the beholder's eyes will seem like scattered pearls. When you gaze upon that scene, you will behold a kingdom blissful and glorious. They shall be arrayed in garments of fine green silk and rich brocade and adorned with bracelets of silver. Their Lord will give them a pure beverage to drink. Thus you shall be rewarded. Your high endeavors are gratifying to Allah. We have made known to you the Quran by gradual revelation. Therefore, wait with patience the judgment of your Lord and do not yield to the wicked and the unbelieving. Remember the name of your Lord morning and evening. In the nighttime, worship him. Praise him all night long. The unbelievers love this fleeting life too well and thus prepare for themselves a heavy day of doom. We created them and endowed their limbs and joints with strength. But if we please, we can replace them by other men. We is capitalized. So it must mean like a host of gods? I don't know. We. This is indeed an admonition. Let him that will take the right path to his Lord. You cannot will except by the will of Allah. Allah is wise and all-knowing. He is merciful to whom he will. But for the wrongdoers, he has prepared a grievous punishment. Gosh, that sounds like the Old Testament, for sure.
Yeah, it does.
I mean,
and they have, like Quirky says, how come, what's with the angels, man? These poor motherfuckers are a bunch of servants. They're slaves to all these people. And basically they have that same concept that Allah has servants that's going to serve you. And if you go to heaven, it's the same thing. Yeah.
But
who
you
are these people? I mean,
but you can understand how it gets misinterpreted as being.
Well, my question too would be like, well, that last part you just read, could that be another way of sinning those that ignore the principles will fall down bruised and bleeding until they wake up at last to them?
I wonder if that's how it originated, but they personified it. Right. Same with, like, the grandparent fantasy.
Someone outside of themselves.
Serving angels.
But see, that passage does not necessarily mean that somebody's going to lord it over you and say,
yeah,
oh,
yeah.
You're a bad person.
Yeah.
It's you who will discover that because
right.
of your experiences.
I'm just saying.
Yeah.
Maybe that got overblown. And I would wonder too, is how many times was the Quran written by all the other?
Yeah, I don't know. It's hard to know. I don't know if it says it in here or not, but yeah, it's interesting though. All right, it says the Quran preaches the oneness of God and emphasizes divine mercy and forgiveness. God is almighty and all-knowing, and though compassionate towards his creatures, he is stern in retribution. Just like the Old Testament God. He enjoins justice and fair dealing, kindness to orphans and widows, and charity to the poor. The most important duties of the Muslims are faith in Allah and his apostle, prayer, almsgiving, fasting, and pilgrimage to the sacred house at Mecca, built by Abraham for the worship of the one God. Interesting that it parallels Judaism and the one God. Muhammad, who disclaimed powers to perform miracles, firmly believed that he was the messenger of God sent forth to confirm previous scriptures. God had revealed his will to the Jews and the Christians through chosen apostles, but they disobeyed God's commandments and divided themselves into schismatic sects. The Quran accuses the Jews of corrupting the scriptures and the Christians of worshiping Christ as the Son of God, although he had expressly commanded them to worship none but him. Having thus gone astray, they must be brought back to the right path, to the true religion preached by Abraham. This was absolute submission or resignation to the will of Allah. Interesting. The merciful. It is the merciful who has taught you the Quran. He created man and taught him articulate speech. The sun and the moon pursue their ordered course. The plants and the trees bow down in adoration. He raised the heaven on high and set the balance of all things, that you might not transgress it. Give just weight and full measure. He laid the earth for his creatures with all its fruits and blossom-bearing palm, chaff-covered grain and scented herbs. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? He created man from potter's clay and the jinn from smokeless fire. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? The Lord of the two easts is he, and the Lord of the two wests. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? He has let loose the two oceans. They meet one another. Yet between them stands a barrier which they cannot overrun. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Pearls and corals come from both. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? His are the ships that sail like banners upon the ocean. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? All who live on earth are doomed to die, but the face of your Lord will abide forever in all its majesty and glory. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? All who dwell in heaven and earth beseech him. Each day some new task employs him. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Mankind and jinn, we shall surely find the time to judge you. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Mankind and jinn, if you have power to penetrate the confines of heaven and earth, then penetrate them. But this you shall not do except with our own authority. Which of your Lord's blessing would you deny? Flames of fire shall be lashed at you and melted brass. There shall be none to help you. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? When the heaven splits asunder and reddens like a rose or stained leather, which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? On that day, neither man nor genie shall be asked about his sins. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? What is a jinn? Anybody? Jinn, J-I-N-N. The wrongdoers, I've always thought it was a genie type of person, but I don't know. The wrongdoers shall be known by their looks. They shall be seized by their forelocks and their feet. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? That is the hell which the sinners deny. They shall wander between fire and water, fiercely seething. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? But for those that fear the majesty of their Lord, there are two gardens. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Planted with shady trees. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Each is watered by a flowing spring. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Each bears every kind of fruit in pairs. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? They shall recline on couches lined with thick brocade, and within their reach will hang the fruits of both gardens. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? They shall dwell with bashful virgins, whom neither man nor genie will have touched before them. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Virgins as fair as corals and rubies. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Shall the reward of goodness be anything but good? Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? And beside these, there shall be two other gardens. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Of darkest green. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? A gushing fountain shall flow in each. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Each planted with fruit trees, the palm and the pomegranate. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? In each there shall be virgins chaste and fair. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Dark-eyed virgins sheltered in their tents. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Whom neither man nor genie will have touched before them. Which of your Lord's blessings should you deny? They shall recline on green cushions and rich carpets. Which of your Lord's blessings would you deny? Blessed be the name of your Lord, the Lord of majesty and glory. Wow! A lot about virgins in there, hey?
Oh, I can't count them. They're counting that mantra.
I know.
Yeah, I just, like, yeah,
I know, it's like, oh. Anyway, it's interesting. Wow. But, you know, what's, it is interesting to me, though, that, you know, a lot of men who are in prison convert to Muslim.
What?
Men in prison.
Oh, yeah.
Why? Because of that? The promise? Huh?
The words give off a certain vibration.
Yeah. It's just, you know, interesting. I was looking at the jinn, if they've got it. No, they don't really have it. Well, wait. Jinn. Islamic myth. Any of a class of spirits lower than the angels, capable of appearing in human and animal forms and influencing humankind for either good or evil.
The devil will be good.
It's interesting. It's, yeah, interesting. Huh. I mean, yeah. Okay. Noah. We sent forth Noah to his, who is this we? They talk about we. Who are they? We shall surely find the time to judge you. We.
I thought at the beginning it said something like, everything is spoken from God except for where the angels are talking or something.
You mean when I read the intro?
The first one.
The intro? Yeah, I was just curious.
And it presented itself in the sense.
Oh, okay. It says, except in the opening verses and some few passages in which the prophet or the angel speaks in the first person, the speaker throughout is God. So I'm not sure. No.
So is it, when it says we, is that the judging forum or whatever?
I don't know. I'm just curious. I was sitting there thinking, who is we? It's interesting because, you know, it's so understandable why the Muslims and the Christians had such a war going on. Because they each thought they were the right way, right? Because of Christ and because of Muhammad. And I'm sure that that was not the intention when
either one,
you know, it's interesting.
Because all they're doing is talking about basically really the principles, only they're explaining it in, you know, historic terms.
Anyway, we sent forth Noah to his people saying, give warning to your people before a woeful scourge overtakes them. He said, my people, I come to warn you plainly. Serve Allah and fear him and obey me. He will forgive you your sins and respite you till an appointed time. When Allah's time arrives, none shall put it back. Would that you understood this. Lord, said Noah, day and night I have pleaded with my people, but my pleas have only added to their aversion. Each time I call on them to seek your pardon, they thrust their fingers in their ears and draw their cloaks over their heads, persisting in sin and bearing themselves with insolent pride. I called out loud to them and appealed to them in public and in private. Seek forgiveness of your Lord, I said. He is ever ready to forgive you. He sends down for you abundant rain from heaven and bestows upon you wealth and children. He has provided you with gardens and with flowing rivers. Why do you deny the greatness of Allah when he has made you in gradual stages? Can you not see how he created the seven heavens, one above the other, placing in them the moon for a light and the sun for a lantern? Allah has brought you forth from the earth like a plant, and to the earth he will restore you. Then he will bring you back afresh. He has made the earth a vast expanse for you. so that you may traverse its spacious paths. And Noah said, Lord, my people disobey me and follow those whose wealth and children will lead them to perdition. They have devised an outrageous plot and said to each other, do not renounce your gods. Do not forsake Wad or Sawa. Or someone else, or whatever. They have led many men astray. You surely drive the wrongdoers to further error. And because of their sins, they were overwhelmed by the flood and cast into the fire. They found none to help them besides Allah. And Noah said, Lord, do not leave a single unbeliever in the land. If you spare them, they will mislead your servants and beget none but sinners and unbelievers. Forgive me, Lord, and forgive my parents and every true believer who seeks refuge in my house. Forgive all the faithful, men and women, and hasten the destruction of the wrongdoers. It sounds like kind of the story of Noah in the Bible.
Yes.
Really. I mean, it's kind of the same thing. Interesting. And it talks about they must have been worshiping, do not forsake so-and-so and so-and-so. They have led many men astray. Do not renounce your gods. So it's like some of the things we were talking about, Babylon and Sumeria and all that, you know, that we're worshiping many gods instead of just one god. I just don't understand why they were worried about having one god instead of many. But it's, I mean, and it's permeated all our society now. You know, and the thing is that one God, there is one force, basically. It is all one.
But Akhenaten did. He was a pharaoh, remember? He went to the one God, created a whole city and everything, just, and all the people, well, all the priests got all pissed off because he walked away from all their gods and said, there was just one of us, the sun. But I think he was talking about, just like what a lot of people talk about, it's the force behind it.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering if it's a reflection of jealousies that the man has. Someone wants to be rich and famous. They don't want attention spread out across multiple gods. They want it all.
Yeah. It's just a reflection of man.
Man's characteristics.
Yeah, ego.
Insecurities. Yeah. Without God, or if I were God, I would want to share the attention with other gods. I don't want to have it all.
If you're really God, but you wouldn't give a rat's ass, right?
But I wonder, well, I guess maybe the way it's stated, you know, Allah and God, sometimes I wonder if we, you know, if it was misinterpreted as being, instead of the force, you know, that is the creator of everything and, you know, this, yeah, I don't know. I just
find it all. He gets everything.
Yeah,
else.
And that, it, anyway.
Yeah, then maybe the gods got away from the one force.
And yet, in reality, it's all saying the same story. I mean, it's a beautiful story, and it's a nice way to express it to, you know, people
different.
In that era.
Mm-hmm.
You know, about, you know,
from the one comes down.
Taking care of your fellow company. Fellow man. And I think all of the prejudice stuff is basically born out of man's ego and clubism. You want to join our group, it's not their group. But I think behind it, the story behind it, you know, of peace and forgiveness and charity and all of that, it should be absorbing all of that, right? It should be beyond all of those things.
But it seems like it gets lost.
It gets lost as soon as you characterize it into our club, our particular way of doing things, and separates it from their way.
Something divine got dumbed down to fit our.
Yeah, just theology and shit. You know, you just got adding stuff to it. But that's how you make it. That's how you make sororities and fraternities and any club going, right? You have certain parameters, and we're this group and they're that group.
Yeah, that's sort of the
But, you know, I would imagine that Allah would, I mean, Muhammad was trying to talk to people just like, you know, Christ, to get them.
Or Buddha
or any of them, you know, to think outside of themselves.
Right.
And, you know, and I guess somehow fear creeps in somehow, because how are you going to get, I mean, in that time, I don't know. It's interesting.
Well, they try more to like impose it on them, where it's a personal thing that happens when it's unhappy to that person.
But some people need guidelines and laws and that sort of thing, and that's kind of what.
You come out of a time years. I mean, as we crawl out of the trees, tribism.
Right.
Was a way of survival.
Exactly.
And so by whichever type of philosophical belief you rode you went down, you built a tribal community or a protective community around it. And I think that mental business that we had when we were, you know, climbing out of the trees, living in caves, you know, that same insecurity just grew along with us.
But when you think about, you know, the, you know, people, they were much more tied to nature in so many ways, and they really would have worshipped, you know, fire, water,
the natural things.
You know, natural things, you know, many gods, you know, they would have, I don't know what paganism actually, you know, worships, but isn't it more close to a nature? How do the pagan? What do the pagans believe?
They worship the forces of nature.
Exactly.
The rain, and they fear the thunder and the rain and some of the other things.
But it's always thought of as something very negative.
Right.
Paganism.
Because it comes back to, well, if you're not worshiping our God, bad dogs.
Well, the whole thing, which is really kind of funny, because the whole, you know, you've got someone's got the star, five-pointed star, right? And it represents the mathematics of creation. And there's the star. It's a great representation of creation. But yet, when Pythagoras, when he was basically a Hermetic philosopher, his symbol was the five-pointed star. You know, it was upside down because it doesn't really make any difference, but it happened to be a star. And back then, when you traveled from one place to another, there was no Motel 6, right? So you look for somebody who would put you up for the night, you'd maybe work or give them some food or give them some money so you could stay at their place. And so as you travel around the countryside, if you had somebody that had a five-pointed star on their door, and you happened to be a follower of Pythagoras, you'd go, this person thinks the same as me, I'm going to stay there. And the Jews have the little talus that's on their door. They have a little talus that you put out there and you pray to it when you ask for blessings before you go into the house. But anyway, and so it's basically the same kind of thing. It's a way for people to recognize each other. And when Christianity started taking hold, everybody was worshiping on Sunday. And Christians worship like the Jews on Saturday, right? But you had to work all the time to feed yourself, right? So you're working all the time. You maybe take one day off you're not busting your ass, baby, right? And they took it off on Sunday. And the Christians and the Jews took it off on Saturday. Well, the Christians had a hard time getting converts to come to their church on a Saturday. So they moved their religious meeting day or the holy day to a Sunday. That's how Christianity moved to Sundays, away from the Jewish Saturdays, in order to convert all the people that were following the nature of the Pythagoras, people that worship the sun, you know, because the sun shines and it makes life happen, trees and rain and shit. Anyway, I'll keep shut up.
No.
Sorry.
But I remember, you know, when I was raised Catholic, because I was growing up Catholic, and, you know, I heard about paganism. I mean,
yeah, I know.
And like, remember what you said? Once you instill fear, I mean, now I look at it and how conscious, like the Church of Satan, how much more conscious that all is. But remember what you said? Once you instill fear in someone, all critical thinking goes out the door. That's what happened.
Yeah. So you see somebody with that thing on the devil worship.
I couldn't consider paganism or look into it and everything then. It was like
off the table.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Well, the word witch used to be wise woman.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, you know, and then it's sort of,
yeah. Well, we're done.
Okay.
We'll stop right there. All right. Are you okay to just do a closing? Okay. Okay. You want to unlock the door for Austin? Oh, or check the ball.
Who was?
Eden.
Any comments from anyone?
No.
Okay.